Next session is about network security. Loom is a well-known network architect and moved into security architecture and came from Philips and now is at Atos.
Yep.
And he's going to tell us all about how to work with security in a network fashion and how to do that in up into the layers. So take it away. Thank you.
Okay, thank you for the introduction. And in this case, to be honest, this presentation is something that I normally do in 3 hours. So I will only cover the top of the iceberg. But if you want more information or something like more detailed information, just let me know. This information, how to contact me, and also if necessary, we can do this in detail. Layered security bomb, there is something going on in our society. The challenges, the security threats we are dealing with are a lot more complex than they used to be. And to be honest, with the Internet of Things, the home devices, bring your own and all the other stuff that's coming on, big data, it's all around us. The world is changing and we really have to deal with that. If not, we will end up with a world where nobody can't trust anybody anymore. And that's a very dangerous situation. So we must, in one way or another, control that enormous flow of information that's all around. Big data is a reality. Processing big data is also a reality. So we can't escape that. So we really must put into place the means and the methods and our way of dealing with it, organizing it in a safe way. This story is how we can do that, how we can go from where we are today to where we are going. In a controlled way. The presentation is not about products or something. I'm working with Atos for many years. It doesn't say anything about the products we are selling or the services we are delivering. Of course, we can do something with it if somebody's interested later, but the story is absolutely product service neutral. It's guiding you how to go from the situation as where we are today and to deal with the challenging there today and the coming ones. For further reading, the story was actually developed to guide my customers. I'm a product manager for security and network services within Atos, to guide our customers from the current situation, what they have installed and how they are organized today, to the future or the next generation of protection and the next way of analysis in a controlled way. Because lots of safety, lots of more nice products around, lots of security devices and features and services and products to control security. But how do I deal with that? How do I put all components like a jigsaw together that they form a good new service, and how does it fit all together? For further reading, there is a document. Over here is the name. You can see that in handouts. But the easiest way to get the document is just PM me. You won't be spammed. You won't be sending it to Atos. You are sending it to me, frans.vanleuven@atos.net. That's all that's there. It's on the end again also. And I will forward you the white paper, which is 25 pages about what I'm telling now in, let's say, half an hour with questions afterwards. What we're dealing with is basically this. I actually got this from the data breach report from 2013. The year doesn't matter too much from Verizon. What the really important fact is that we need to be aware of how the world is changing in the different types of attacks and penetrations that we get from whoever is on the network or anywhere in our society and tries to do something nasty with our data. What we see is that the numbers of the attacks actually are starting to vary a lot. You have lots of different what the professionals call attack factors, and they may be changing from minutes in infections, traveling out around the world very fast, to targeted attacks, which may last for a year or at least months. What I'm talking about, if you make the comparison with the burglary, it's very easy. You have the junkie, which is looking for some easy money to buy the next drugs. He's walking through the streets and he looks for open windows, open doors, or easy access to a facility, steal your laptop or something else, and he's gone. So that's the casual attack, the drive-by attack of minutes, which also happens on the internet. But you might have also a very nice collection of antique clocks, or you have something other. You are keeping some diamonds at home because you are obscurely trading in these things, and somebody knows about that, and he's doing a targeted attack at you. Then he looks for weakness in your house, in your patterns when you are away, what you do when you are not away, what your protections are, and he might be doing burglary, which actually takes a couple of months of preparation. On the internet, the same happens. If somebody in your organization wants to steal some data, it can be well prepared, taking up a preparation time of long periods and short periods. That's the first bullet we are talking about, the first round on the pitch.
This one.
Yeah. Next one is, how long does it take to be affected, or that somebody is on your systems and you are not aware of it? Any idea? How long it takes on the average organization? There are some statistics on that. Who thinks that in his organization there is nothing compromised? That's not a single system with something on it. Okay. I'm in the right community over here. You are laughing because they say, okay, we know that we are affected. The only difference between our... Yeah, you think that? Okay, that's a good exception. I would like to challenge you to be honest. Or you have no systems, could be as well. I'm a security guy myself. I think I do a good job to keep my PC clean, but do I guarantee that there's nothing on it? I'm almost sure there's at least something that I wouldn't like to be there. So that's a problem, that's a fact of life. There are organizations that are aware they are affected, and there are organizations that aren't aware that they are affected. The time to discover if something is the variable. So what we need to do is getting from being infected to detect that we are infected, how we are infected, and how big the infection or what the consequences are. The last bullet is about discovery and containment. I think the next picture actually says something better about this. I borrowed this picture from NIST, and actually it's one of the very good documents. The source is beneath on how this all works. Comparison sometimes helping it. I see that organizations very often in a third block, when something actually happens and you have to deal with a compromise, a data theft, or something that happened what you don't want to happen, and you are dealing with it, that they throw and say, when is it solved? It's not being about being solved, because you don't solve these things. You really have to be aware of the different phases: containment, eradication, and recovery. And sometimes an analogy with the ship helps, for instance. And I sometimes put in the analogy with the ship, which has protections in the sense of preparations. We all remember the Titanic, and that's on a smeeting trip. It actually went down the drain for an issue. We have now a new Titanic, which actually is 3 or 4 times as big. It's just boarded the harbor of Rotterdam yesterday, I believe, or the day before yesterday. And what they do is, of course, again, say, we have lots of preparation. This ship is unsinkable and never will happen again. So what you do in, you put in some bulk pumps. Those are the pumps if there's water detected in the lower parts of the ship to get the water out. You put some watertight doors, you have maybe some bars that can be elevated when water is detected. There's an alarm system which detects if there's a rupture of the hull or something. And then the yell of the red light starts to beep, and the horns are sounded on the ship that there's something wrong. That's all preparation. That's where your firewalls, your IDSs, and all the other security systems for the ICT networks are. Preparation. Next, you have detection and analysis. Detection and analysis is, in this case, that those horns, the detectors of water, and the alarm system on the ship, when there is a breach, so there is a hit, they hit an iceberg, then the you must know that you actually did it, not visually only, but also for if as a consequence a water is entering the ship. So that's the tagging systems. In ICT systems, we are talking about SIEM implementations and other implementations that forward your alerts to the central system. They aggregate all events coming from all sensors that you have on your ICT infrastructure, and you start to detect what's going on. So when you do that, then you have a SOC or something, or a NOC, a SOC combination. That's an operation that works 7 times 24 hours, because you want to know when something happens around the clock and you want to be alarmed, pull out of your bed, is it even serious enough? So you really need that to be in place, like on the ship. That's detection. Analysis is, for instance, a SIEM system with all aggregation of all the logins and alerts coming together on the nice screens where the operators are looking at all the events. Next comes the containment. What's the containment about? In this case, the ship hits the iceberg, water is entering in the ship, and what you do is contain it. So you raise the bars, the doors that are in the ship, the watertight doors are closed, the pumps are starting to pump water out, and now you hope that containing it by closing the compartments where the breach actually occurred, and the water pumps are capable enough to keep the boat floating. At the moment that you're in that situation, that what's coming in and what's going out at least is the same amount that's coming in, you are contained. So you know there's nothing happening anymore. On the ICT environment, we have the same. You are contained. It means that the infection or the penetration, you know where it is, where the data leak is going, what type of information is going out, and which resources are being compromised. At the moment that you know that, you can watch those and control what's going in and out and start stopping that it more will escape or that it spread to more systems. That's about eradication. So if you avoid that it's spreading to other systems, then you are starting to call it. For the ship, again, at the moment that you do, the pumps are being activated, the doors are closed, now you send the crew in, with divers or whatever, you look for the rupture, you start welding it or put something against it that no water comes in, the pumps keep on pumping, and at a certain moment the ship is empty again. It's floating, no water comes in, and the water that was that got in, you got it out again. Eradication. Recovery is about cleaning up the mess afterwards, because if the ship is really entered a lot of water, then it's a real mess in there. So getting it refurbished and cleaned up again is a lot of work. Also in ICT, you have to recover. Clean up. Know what's compromised, which systems were compromised, which data I got out, this is not safe anymore, I must replace it or inform people, all that stuff. So these phases really keep them in the mind. The story is about how to do that in the past and how to do that in the future. Thus yeah. Far, everybody with me. In the past, we had typically in a network like this, and what you see over here is a number of components in the network. I see over here some load balancers, I see firewalls, I see firewalls on the internet, I see a firewall coming into the DMZ zone, I see a firewall between front and back end systems. Lots of firewalls. Is that so useful? For terminology, one statement. I define a firewall, traditional firewall, is the box that does IP address filtering and port filtering on the UDP TCP port. That I call a traditional firewall. Second generation firewall, I call that same firewall combined with IDS, IPS functionality. Yeah. A third generation firewall, or next generation firewall as I call it, that's a firewall that has three main characteristics in it. And all vendors have different definitions than mine, but for my story, they have three things. They are user aware, they are application aware, and they are content aware. And they do this by deep inspection. Yeah? So if I say application aware, I know This is SAP in a VPN tunnel in an HTTP header. Yeah. I still know that it's SSP. And if the port number is 23, which is not really assigned to SAP, I don't care, I don't give a fuck. It's still what SAP, deep inspection used for that. And application recognition is also for homebrew application. How I do this, I won't deal with it, but this is in the document. So, these three things, user awareness, application awareness, content awareness. A content awareness is, this is an executable, which may be hidden in a zip file, but I unzip it and I discover that it is an executable. The extension I don't like what they put behind it, because everybody can fake that. Yep. So that's up on the board. And ADC is an application delivery controller. I use the term ADC a lot, and that's a smart load balancer. It's a big IP from F5, or a Citrix Netscaler, or an Altium from Radware, these type of boxes, but then used for various functions. Not doing traditional load balancing, they do this as well, but they do also advanced functions. Yeah. And I see lots of organizations that actually buy lots of very expensive F5 big IPs, very good boxes, very smart boxes, and most of them are being used as stupid as possible. They are doing what they were doing 50 years ago. Yeah? I say in a new story, really use intelligent boxes in an intelligent way, because if not, you have a problem. This is the old layering. With all the firewall stuff and some other provisions. This is always a balancing cost of things. I won't go in detail on this one. This is just a representation of the last one. The perimeter, traditional perimeter defenses, the front end and the back end that we have to protect in a different way. What we need today is really, and that's a bit our complex picture action. And there are lots of components in it. So this is the front end, this is the way application landscape sits, and this is the back end supporting the database and all the stuff supporting your front end applications. And you need layers of defenses on all three of them. The moral of the story is, don't redo what you already did. So if the external part of connectivity, where VPNs coming in, firewalls to your providers, partners, etc., and the internet. If you have a strong defense over there, DDoS is installed. You control the flows on it. DDoS have various flavors of it. And you have, of course, a basic IDS in detection mode, not in active mode. Because if not, you get a truckload of false positives, and probably when they have peak end months of something, yeah, you are stopping things that you wouldn't like to stop. So you must control it in a different way. If you put a firewall, statement firewall in here, all sessions are already inspected if the typical aspects of a stateful inspection. If you put another firewall on another layer, the only thing that you do is nail down the filter. Yeah. You make it smaller, the community is reduced further, but content-wise or something else, nothing else will come out from that file anymore. Only when an alarm hits you, because there is some sequence error or some injection or something, it will happen. All these links and all these firewalls will scream the same things. At least I hope they will scream the same things. If not, they are not doing their work. So, if you do something over there, don't redo it on the other links. Yeah, that's the story. I always translate it in a modern data center, in the data center itself, in the processing facility, if that's cloud-based on your own premises or outsourced, doesn't matter, you don't need firewalls there anymore. What do they have against firewalls? What's wrong with firewalls in all places?
Maintenance,
yeah, that's one thing.
Costs,
yeah.
Complexity.
Why is firewall complex? Because I can automate the rule setting of firewall and give me the rules and I push it to all firewalls. That's not complicated. Where is the complexity?
I think the whole traffic going through different kinds of firewalls and all kinds of firewalls, I think that could be much complexer than only one firewall doing all kinds of stuff.
No. Okay. This is one part of it. The big problem about firewalls in the data center is they use IP spaces as the variable to control. In other words, if I have an SMP environment or another environment and I have development, testing, production, they say I need a firewall because I don't want the testing guys to enter the production environment and vice versa. Mapping those bloody IP spaces to the users that actually must get to the development, that's complex because he's company A, he's doing now development for me. Next year is contracting here, a freelancer or something, that's a P over there. So people doing the various jobs are coming from everywhere. So I have to adjust people to IP addresses floating around everywhere. If I move the service from my in-house service to a provider or to a cloud environment, then all those IP addresses change again. What a stupid way. User awareness is the magical answer. So I think I don't want to do this with the traditional way. I want to do this with a smart way on this layer. And on this layer I say application awareness, user awareness, and content awareness. So I put in something that actually takes the extra users to control who's going in. What you can use for that is the next generation firewall of different brands, and above all, don't forget it, ADCs. All ADCs today are capable to interface with your identity management. Could be Active Directory or something else. So instead of using the bloody IP addresses to distinguish between development, testing and production, I actually say this group of people in my database, I have registered, these are testers. Internal, external, I don't know, mind, as long as I are identified, well, best by the strong authentication, I know which in community they are. So I don't read different zones in my network anymore. I have just a bunch of servers over here, and these are the testing, these are the development, and these are production. And if something goes wrong with my production, because the server has havoc, or I have an end of the month run, or a special case, I did a special promotion or something, I get a lot more users than I usually. I just switch off testing and add these resources to production. As they are in the same VLAN, in the same network zone, I said, no problem with that. How do I control users on the identity, not on IP addresses? So all that stuff is gone. Yeah? So developing, changing, moving resources is a lot simpler than it used to be. And these boxes do that almost for free. So use the layered architecture of it and combine as many functions on the same box as you can. So if you say, I want to reach a single sign-on, if all the applications run to the same load balancer, which in this case is doing sign-off offload for all applications behind it, you have realized single sign-on with almost no cost, because all those applications now ask at the load balancer, hey, is this guy authorized to go into my application? That is done. And you have only once to organize your strong authentication, because your load balancer is doing that for you. And regardless if it's a legacy old application that doesn't understand SMS tokens and all that stuff, you offload all those activities. That's the moral of the story of a layer of defenses. So change, do at each layer in a controlled way as you need to do it. Questions about it? I don't mind questions, by the way. As long as how does this look like in a picture? You see on the coarse graph filtering, as I call it, that's where your traditional firewall is, where your IDS is, where your DDoS detections are, is on the outside. That is for the internet access, but also on your partners and VPN access. Because everybody is treated as being potentially harmful. Trusting your community, your users, that they behave well and that their platforms behave well, forget about it. Because everybody has one of these, and when they are at home, they connected to the internet. I do, because I have to work at home, for instance, and all the stuff. We have partners, etc. So trusting that the machine, the platform they use, that is uncompromised, is a dangerous game. Because of lots of things about these things. So you have to inspect all that traffic after decryption. So your inspection that you do over here in fine-grained filtering is always looking into VPN sessions. And if there is an HTTP session, inside the VPN, you look in the HTTP session again. Because you know it, things from the, there's a shift that attacks more and more on per on encrypted sessions. The same reasons as with analogies, I always like a good analogy. Burglars, when you start with that, I have them as well. Rolwijken in Dutch, it's a good word for it, but our blinds. If you have a window with blinds, then people think that's a good protection against burglary, because it makes noise when you need to break in, because it's an obstacle that's there. But on the other hand, burglars in general, they don't dislike these blinds too much, because once they get in, they can even switch on the light and look at the leisure for the things that are interesting to them. Because they are now in a closed, invisible environment. The same happens with encrypted communication. People, organizations think once you are inside that nothing can happen to you. Forget about it. Because the users and the endpoints are the endpoints. Things hoover yourself about, by the way. So this is how we deal with this. Behavior analysis is something that you have to do on the whole stuff. And for behavior analysis, and we're going back to this one, you do that with things like advanced status detecting, network data loss prevention tools, and all these products. But basically, advanced threat detection does. I think it was on this picture. Okay. It's in an appendix, it doesn't matter. What you do is put in some sensors, which is like a sniffer in the past and an analyzer that really taps all your traffic into an analysis tool and that looks for vulnerabilities. Are the data files that are suspected? Send them to a sandbox for analysis. If it's really the case, when it comes back, then we know if it's dangerous or not. You don't do this real time. You do the capture real time, but you send that file to the sandbox for analysis if you are not familiar with its content and you don't trust it. It comes back maybe and it says it was infected. Then you have to look back with your tools to which systems actually got this file over time. And then you can do, again, detection, eradication, and recovery. You do recovery once you know which system got that file, then you can remove it and see what the consequence was of running that file. And you probably can even check if you have these tools running also on your endpoints, if it was run and what the consequences of that run was. And you may have to reinstall some PCs or servers to deal with this. A special case of inspection is dealing with cloud and cloud services. And my statement really is you have to deal with cloud services and services where the users, internal, the partners, whatever, but anybody who is accessing some data which belongs to your corporate organization, that's really the norm for it. You must control them. So, and how do you do that? I use the term choke points for it. For this, choke point is a military term. Choke point is in the communication part, in the roads or in the railroads or the rivers. It's a natural point where all communication needs to pass. And then I put in checkpoint Charlie. Say, hey, analyze everything that it bypasses here and be sure that it works that way. So as a corporate organization, in the past there was a lot of discussion if you have public internet access, if you needed to do that per location, per office, each place where your users were sitting, or on a central place. And who is doing this today via a central place? Say, in my organization, all traffic goes via this gateway and then goes to the internet. Who says I do that? Each office has its own open internet access. I'm missing a lot of hands.
Yeah, it isn't fair. Huh? It isn't fair because we only have one office.
Okay, if you have one office, then it's valid. Yeah. Okay, but the point is that you need the controls, and putting the controls in place, and the DDoS and all the other services, we are getting bloody expensive these days. So controlling that you are not jeopardized by one or another security event is getting more costly than having all the traffic diverted to a central place and going then to the public internet. So most organizations today do this. For the future, I say you need really need choke points. Choke points go a bit further. They say, if I'm sitting at home at my PC and I'm using Azure from Microsoft, I go from my corporate choke point, the internet, I go to a central place, maybe a service on the internet contracted from a provider. It doesn't need to be your corporate headquarters, but you need a choke point. I go there, I do analysis, I do decryption, I do inspection, I do behavior analysis on it, and then my traffic goes to Azure. Because I want to know if somebody is now extracting data from Azure, which is confidential, or looking into documents which he shouldn't be looking at. Look at the policeman who got access to everybody has files and was selling them to the mob in the Netherlands. So you really want to control who is doing what and when habits change. If somebody changes the types of files, changes the volumes of files, changes the location of files that he actually is looking in or manipulating in any way, you want to be aware of. And if that's on your corporate service, on traditional applications, or on new cloud-based services, it doesn't matter. So I say, use the same layered approach with all the three layers in it. User awareness, location awareness, content awareness, and behavior analysis also for your external communication. That's the basic story. Question about this? This is the impact on the feasibility.
So what you say encryption, but that means installing a separate certificate authority in everybody's home devices, like in your phone or your laptop, to be able to present sort of man in the middle HTTPS.
At least your applications, when they communicate and there is sensitive data on it, then you need to protect it in an advanced way, and using certificates is definitely one of them. SSL is not good enough these days. Also, it's the PS must be protected at least TLS 1.3, which means certificates. So dealing with certificates for sensitive data is must. So data classification helps in this story. So if you know, and then you must make, if you say this Android platform, for instance, can't handle certificates, then the conclusion is sensitive data of above a certain level may never be put or read by that Android device, unless it is capable to match the rules you assign for that type of data. Lastly, but I can't avoid it, because if not, you're in a very big risk. But really, looking with Android, I'm one of the fans of media players and all that stuff. And I have a 50 terabyte NAS storage at my home for making movies and all that stuff. But if you really do this and you look in the applications that are running on your TV and all other devices, they are as powerful with as much as resources as my PC had 2 years ago. There's a hexa-core in it, there is 4 gigabytes of memory in it, and so if I hack this, it can export as much data as any other device today. So be aware that that's a problem. So don't store confidential stuff on it. You can't only know if there's confidential stuff on it if you use choke points. Because, say, everything that's on my corporate things, where corporate data of mine resides, are always inspected after decryption. And that means that your loan balancer really must get access to the certificates offloaded to them for inspection or your next generation firewall. Indeed. These are the consequences. But definitely, I would say, do it. Maybe do it. Other questions?
Okay. Thanks a lot.